And welcome everybody to another episode of Smart Money Circle. I'm your host, Adam Sarhan. With me today is a very special guest, Jim Ropel, founder of Ropel Capital Management with approximately $100 million in assets under management. Jim, thank you very much for coming on the show.
Adam, nice to meet you. Glad to be here.
Thank you. So I always like to ask, Jim, can you tell us your story and how you got involved in the business?
Sure. You know, it was kind of all around me when I was young. My family, they had no money, but they were kind of watching the market. My father was largely part of it. And then in high school, the Commodore 64 was invented, and my best friend bought some shares in it. And my family, my grandfather worked for Bally Pinball Machines, and they invented Space Invaders, and you know, that stock went to Mars. And my dad kind of liked to dabble in the market, you know, but he didn't have any money. And then when I was in college, my best friend's father was a stockbroker, and he really was into it big time. And then I met another friend who I became pretty close with, who inherited some money. And the three of us really, I mean, this is early in college, junior, senior year, and then the crash of 87 happened. And so the market kind of was just around me. It was meant to be.
Nice. I love it. So I know from before you had started off as a broker and then moved to the money management side. Can you talk a little about that transition?
Yeah, I was very, very lucky in my timing. I mean, I kind of felt like I stepped off the deck of the Titanic onto another ship that smoothly sailed away. The business was not really conducive to transactional business like that I was conducting. It was going to wrap accounts and all that. And I just, CanSlim is not conducive to a retail stockbroker.
Right.
The turnover is too high, and the management in these giant bureaucracies are so afraid of the litigious society we live in. And, you know, they're looking for people to gather assets, and I was really a money manager. So my income would have plunged had I stayed. And so I got, and then I was allowed to be free and to execute as a real money manager as opposed to just a asset gatherer, you know, guy who, you know, brings in the guys $3 million, asset allocates them out, and doesn't really talk to them anymore.
Right.
You know, you're not really allowed to get great performance for anybody. The objective is the brokerage firms are trying to collect fees,
right,
with the least amount of risk of being sued.
Right.
They're not interested in, that's their interest. And everybody's self-interested. Everybody wants to make money with the least amount of risk. I don't blame them, but it's not a good model. I told all my partners, but they were my retail customers. I said, look, right now we are sitting across from each other. We are in an adversarial relationship. What's good for me is not necessarily good for you.
Right.
I go, in the hedge fund structure, what's good for you is good for me. Because number one, I'm the largest owner of the hedge fund equity-wise. And when I make money, you make money, we make money together.
Right.
And that's not the way it is in wrap accounts and mutual funds and all that crap. They get all their fees whether you make or lose. It's like, you know, trading places. Whether the customer makes money or loses money, Duke and Duke make the commission.
That's a very good way of putting it. Yeah, no, I started off as a Series 7 broker as well, moved over to 65 land and RIA land because I had the same exact, almost parallel experience where it just didn't make sense. It wasn't scalable, yada, yada, yada. So I definitely understand what you're saying there. So
it's just a better model. And this is really what so aggravates me. I mean, I'm a big libertarian, but so the government precludes poor people or lower income people from having access to the greatest money managers because they have a threshold. You've got to have all these minimum requirements to put money in a hedge fund.
Right.
So what's that do? It leaves only the mediocre and lesser quality managers. So what, only the rich people can have a hedge fund? That's bullshit.
Yeah, really. I couldn't agree with you more. And the quote unquote sophisticated investor guideline and all that kind of fun stuff, that makes no sense. Or even putting caps on you on what you can invest in or how much you can invest in, all that kind of stuff.
Once again, the government with a great intention hurts the people they're trying to help.
Right. No, that definitely resonates loud and clear on my end. So, Jim, can you tell us a little about your investment strategy, please?
I am a real strict disciplinarian implementing the CanSlim system. Now, there's a few interpretations of how you can implement that. I would quantify myself as a intermediate term position trader, trend trader, fundamental trader. I'm not a trader. I don't like that term at all. I don't get in and out of things quickly unless I'm at a loss. My ideal would be to have a follow-through day in the general market, get really, really long, and then sit for, you know, 9 to 18 months, and then get all out. So I really want to be known as a position trader. Nice. Anything short-term, I am really bad at. I mean, it would, there's my answer.
Nice. So how do you interpret CAN/SLIM differently? Because I know there's a lot of people that have tried CAN/SLIMs, some make money, some don't, like anything else in life. But how are you able to take it and take it to the next level, so to speak?
Do you tweak it? I think...
Yep, go ahead.
It's personality traits and time. It's the right personality traits mixed with experience. Any method you choose for almost anything in life has got to agree with you intrinsically. It's got to be, it can't make you uneasy. CAN/SLIM just completely agrees with me. And like I said, I've said this a bunch of times, even publicly, I'm really not a very disciplined person in my personal life,
right.
But in this life, I am the most disciplined person in the world. And what's kept me in the game is discipline, is cutting losses, is not jumping at every little stock that hops out of a digestion, and consistently implementing with discipline. I mean, over the long, long stretch.
Got it. So the inability for people to make money with CAN/SLIM, would you say it's just based on their personality traits, their inability to be disciplined by following the rules? Or is it just the fact that you're able to take those rules and then tweak them to make them work for you?
I think it's that they can't withstand the short-term adversity. It's not CAN/SLIM for a month or a year. It's CAN/SLIM for 10, 5, 10. I think you have to implement the rules for a full bull and bear cycle.
Got it.
To objectively determine, is it for you? Can you execute? Because any stretch of even a year, I mean, I've seen periods where CAN/SLIM just has not worked. The market's been choppy, and people just can't take a bunch of small losses. They're like, this system sucks.
Right.
Yeah. Well, it doesn't suck, actually. Yeah, it's probably one of the better ones out there. It totally agrees with me. But people who can't implement it either are looking for action. They want, they like the action, the buying, the selling, the winning, the losing. They're not into the process. Or people expect results immediately. It's patience, and it's patience to be implemented over very long stretches. Anybody can do this. You do not have to be a brilliant person. What you do is you have to be consistent for long stretches, and nobody wants to hear that. People want to make money now.
Right, right. It's all about right here, right now. So I have a interesting little twist on that. So I started off as a CAN/SLIM guy way back when, and then I kind of morphed into my own little world. I developed a third school of thought. You're familiar with fundamental and technical analysis. A third one I call psychological analysis for markets, and I have a book coming out with Wiley soon about it. And the concept is real simple, Jim. It's people are making emotional decisions with their money, not rational, even though they think they're making rational ones. And that therein lies the entire crux of why people can't get ahead in the market, because they can't get out of their own way. And it kind of echoes what you say and what your experience is.
I couldn't agree with you anymore. The emotional component is, it's like the guy who's in the NBA finals. He's got to make this three, and he's been red hot the whole game. But all of a sudden, as he's down court, he's being blocked. He goes, these guys bullied me when I was in third grade and made fun of me in front of a bunch of girls. And they miss the three-pointer and loses the game.
Yeah, seriously. I love that.
What your upbringing was like, whether you were brought up rich or poor, or if your parents praised you or beat you up, all that, the market will expose your emotional weaknesses, and it will do it very quickly.
Yeah.
That is critical. Technicals, fundamentals, and emotional. Anybody can learn the rules. Anybody who can read can read the rules.
Right.
But to implement them and overcome your emotional battle. Loeb's book, Battle for Investment Survival,
yeah.
Well, it was battle for overcoming your emotional failures or frailties.
Right. No, that's a really good point. So you ever hit a wall when you're doing anything, learning something or exercising, whatever it is?
Absolutely. I mean, I preach a lot of things,
yeah.
But don't take that as I execute that flawlessly. there are periods when I am in the zone.
Right.
But there are more, I would probably say I'm working to get in sync or, you know, more often than not. I mean, there are periods where I've done really stupid things. Like in 2013, I was convinced that Europe was going to come undone. And I did trend follow, but every time the market would roll over, I thought, well, the world's coming to an end. Europe can't survive in the Eurozone.
Right.
And I would get out of everything, and I should have never have done that, especially right. in the era of quantitative easing,
right.
where a 4% drawdown in the index historically might have led to a 15 or 20. Well, it stopped dead at 4, 4.5, and went into new highs.
Right.
Had I not been so overwhelmingly negative and cognizant of it and put a guardrail around myself, I would have... You know, I had a very mediocre period of performance around there and it went on for 2 years.
Oh, wow. Yeah, it's a mental state. 13 was one of the best years, too, for the market, right? It was up, what, 30% or something like that? But it was that same thing. QE just ripped it higher, and that was it.
All yeah, and I mean, it's kind of like trend following is if you can follow the trend against your emotions and feelings is one of the most beautiful things in the world. Like this year, everybody was aware of what was happening in China with C-19,
right.
but the U.S. equity market just kept roaring.
Right.
So if you didn't stay with the trend, you would have missed a great opportunity.
Oh, absolutely.
But then when it rolled over,
right.
if you didn't get out, you would have been obliterated.
Right.
So to say I am cognizant of what's occurring in Europe and around the world and Asia, and then stay long stock. That's pretty darn hard.
Yeah, no question. No question.
So it's a battle for emotional control.
Yeah, so these walls, whenever you hit a wall, I call these things mental walls, right? So you hit a wall, okay, great. Most people shy away from it. They run away. But the successful people, at least that I've studied, and this whole show is called Smart Money Circle because I want to study and learn from the smartest guys out there and gals, is that they're able to look at pain, like Dalio talks about, and they drive right through it and they get to the other side. So how do you overcome those mental walls that come up, Jim, and time again? Like when you're in a funk or you're off for whatever reason, how are you better at getting aware of it, like that self-mastery, or does it take you time? And then how do you snap out of it?
It's not giving up. Okay, in this period of – I'm looking out my window right now, and it's dead. I'm living a little town. I'm in the center of town. There's a big triangle of streets in a major area.
Right.
There's no one here. And I went out with a bike for a bike ride. And I was actually able to think clearly. And I was thinking about some of the really dramatically negative things that happened to me in my life. And I said, thank God they happened.
Right.
At the time, I was distraught.
Right.
And now I look back on it and I'm like, I didn't give up. I redoubled my efforts and it made me a way better person. So when you have these walls, you call them, yeah. whatever, you know, you have to focus on it, analyze it, and come back. And that maybe separates where people never evolve and other people evolve to amazing. I think Dalio's principles is kind of I won't say it's a defining thing for me, but I went through it and took notes on the whole, oh. You know, the 9 30-minute videos.
Yeah. It's beyond.
I took notes on the whole thing and I forced my daughter to sit with me and do it.
Good move. No, it's fantastic.
But he's right.
Yeah, he is. So how do you interpret Dalio's principles and how do you use those for trading and has it made you better?
Well, I think that I'm going to paraphrase, but yeah. brutal honesty in evaluation is critical. You've got to be evolved enough to understand you're making mistakes. You need to realize them. And it's best to have someone critique you because you can't see yourself. I can't see myself.
Right.
Someone looking in from the outside is like, it's obvious you're buying extended.
Oh,
you've got FOMO.
Yeah.
You know, your position's too big. But when you're self-critiquing, you're not really so objective. People, even an evolved person may not be evolved at the very highest level to cut through all the crap.
No, it's not.
You know, criticism that stings is true. So, criticism that doesn't sting is a lie.
Yeah, that's actually a really good point.
So criticism that stings, I'm like, whoa, hey, there's a red hot button there. I need to focus on this issue if I want to get better. And I'm willing to absorb, to take the pain to get there.
So that's a really good point you bring up. So it's one of these things, Jim, where it's called the personal blind spot bias, right? It's a cognitive bias. We all have it. If you ask 100 newlyweds how many think they're going to get divorced, no one's going to raise their hand, or almost nobody. But 50%, we know statistically, are going to get divorced, right? I speak and you speak, traders all over the country, if not all over the world. How many think they're going to beat the market? Almost everybody raises their hand. Yet statistically, we know it's the exact opposite. So that's overcoming that personal blind spot bias you speak about. How do you do it? Do you get external help, or that you just sit there with yourself and say, hey, Jim, get it, you know, get going? Or how, I'm just curious, how do you actually get that brutal honesty?
I always tried to do it myself. I mean, and I was not really as dutiful as Bill O'Neill would like everyone to be to review every trade. And some years I didn't review any, but the girl who I work with, Eve, she runs my small cap fund for me. We critique each other every week. Mm-hmm. On Sunday night, we send each other a review of our daily observations of each other's trades. And that is real. You know, I like this. I love dealing with successful traders in life as personal friends, because a great trader owns their losses.
Right.
And they own their successes.
Right.
In life, most people will not own their losses.
Right.
They are failures.
Right.
They blame all their fails and losses on other people.
Right.
And they own their successes. Traders, if that's who... If you don't own your losses, you will blow out very quickly.
You're toast. Game over.
And so evaluation is assessment of my losses, of my shortcomings, my bad ideas, my FOMO, or whatever is affecting me at the moment.
Right. So FOMO is just fear of missing out. So you're either chasing it and then you, oh no, I missed a stock. Let me just buy it now. You're reckless. You're chasing it. It's above the pivot point or the ideal buy point or the max buy price. And then on the downside, how do you handle, it's kind of the next question here, how do you handle risk, and what mistakes do you see people make with respect to risk management?
Okay, I was in a group of hedge fund managers a few days after New Year's at a predictions party. We do it every year, and we've been doing it for many years, and one of them said, you know, it's really a testament to everyone in this room, there are five or six of us, that we're all still here. Because most people are not still there because they just don't cut their losses. Risk management is job one. I mean, if you have no other rule, cutting your losses is going to keep you in the game forever.
Right.
If you people who blow out don't cut their losses.
Right. Yeah, no
question. And that is just, it's job one. Risk management, position sizing. You know, I want to tell you, I want to go backwards just a tiny little bit. I wrote this thing because I wanted to tweet it out. And about FOMO, and I'm going to take a couple seconds to find it. And I said, in this recent rally we've just had, there was not a lot of great stocks you should have bought. And I wrote, making excuses to buy faulty bases, extended, short, undeveloped, erratic, jagged, poor volume characteristics are high risk, especially when the eventual index digestion or correction materializes. Every stock exiting a digestion is not a buy point. And then I put hashtag selectivity is critical. So what everybody saw off this recent Fed injected rally off the bottom was, oh my God, it's running away from me. We're going to have a V-shaped bottom.
Right.
So there were a few things that you should have bought, very few. But what happened was people just looked at their accounts with everything that broke over a two-day high.
Right.
And then as things got more and more extended, they said, it's going to run away all the way to new highs without me, and I've got to buy. And then they ended up buying things that were way extended.
Right.
And then you get a day like today, which was absolutely guaranteed to come as sure as the sun's going to go down tonight, and everybody got stopped out.
Right. No, that's a very good point. So,
was that a 30-minute answer to a one-minute question?
No. No, it's actually, it's right on point, because the people that understand it get it. People that don't understand it don't get it. But it's that staying true. And that speaks to your earlier point also about staying true to your discipline, right? And making sure that you follow those rules and you don't break the rules and you go with, you know, the style drift where you just do whatever the thing du jour is and just keep breaking rules, because that doesn't work.
Style drift is a absolute disaster. I have a friend who used to write or work at or manage Morningstar, and they said, when we have a great manager who goes on a losing streak and he style drifts from the upper right hand corner box to the lower left, he goes, we either downgrade him to one star or discontinue coverage.
Oh, wow. That's
because when do you style drift?
When you're losing.
You style drift after a long period of underperformance.
When you're losing, exactly.
And, and so what do? You jump ship right about the time when your style that you've been implementing for 5 years and not working is about to turn. Right. And what do? You get into the hot one for 5 years, which is about to turn the other way. So you compound stupidity.
Right. Right. Yeah, no, actually, I have a thing called, excuse me, it's called the 1 second rule. So how many times, I got this from trading, how many times in life or in markets are you're in a stock and all of a sudden you can't take it anymore, so to speak, and you get out and then boom, it goes the way it should have gone, so on and so forth, right? So it's not literally 1 second, but you know, you're at the red light and you just spaced out, whatever, you put the car in park and then the second you do that, it turns green, whatever the case is. So I've seen that style drift manifest itself, compounding stupidity over and over and over again in so many different facets. It's insane.
You know, Darvish, one reason I think he was so successful was he just took emotion out of it. Buy stops and sell stops.
Right.
When he didn't flinch when the stock's breaking out, it was bought for him without any emotion. It was just done. And when the stop was sold, a sell stop was hit, it wasn't a debate.
Right.
It just got out.
Yeah, 100%.
I mean, imagine, he took the emotion out. I mean, he took the most difficult part out.
And the hardest part for him was when he went back to New York and he actually started trading with the brokers and he got wiped out or annihilated. He left, he went to Paris and redid what he, you know, went back to the basics of what was working. And then boom, he started making money again.
Absolutely. I think that is just a, if that lesson, anybody can understand that, and if you do understand that, you can move forward.
Yeah, actually, Jim, it's good that you brought that up because that's the basis of what I've done. I've learned based on my own self and self-mastery to remove the emotion as much as possible. And that's kind of the premise of the book as well. But in order for me to do that, I literally don't even look at the market during the day. And I just look at markets when markets are closed. And I make my decisions, usually on the weekends, for week ahead. I put the stops in both entries and exits. And that's it. I'm done. And I walk away. And it's been for me, that's helped.
That the advantage that the average investor has over an institutional person like me, and I'm not a giant institution, I mean, I'm not a mid-size, call it, is they can go put a buy stop in for 1,000, 2,000 shares,
right,
or a sell stop. But I can't go out there and put a sell stop in for 300,000 shares or 200, you know, for $20 million worth of stock.
Never going to happen.
I can't do that. Yeah, I've got to watch it.
Right.
And so, you know, size kills performance for a myriad of reasons. The guy who's running $100,000 or $4 or $5 million is so unencumbered. It's the institutional manager, no matter how amazing he is like an Olympic athlete with cinder blocks on his legs.
Yeah,
he's lugging around millions and millions of dollars. He's got the emotional component. He can't put stops in. He may have stop on paper.
Right.
He could call a trader and say, hey, dump this crap.
Right. No, seriously.
You know.
That's how it is. So,
I mean, Stan Druckenmiller is the man. I mean, the man.
Oh, there's no question.
To run that, $15 billion and throw down, compounded out 20, 30, 40% a year it's legendary. Dude, I don't think anyone has done that.
And not even that. He made that money himself. That's the other part of it. That's the other part that blows my mind. So yeah, no question. So let's talk about risk a little bit more detail, if you don't mind, Jim. Yeah, O'Neill talks about selling at 7 or 8% below your entry price as far as getting out. If you do that and position sizing, you brought that up also. How do you structure a portfolio? Let's say you have, you know, whatever, $100 in there or $100,000 or $1 million, doesn't make a difference. What do you do? Do you take 10% positions and then put a 7 or 8% stop? Because if you put 100% of your position in one stock and sell it for an 8% loss, you do that three times, you lost 21% of your book. So you can speak to that.
Okay, let's go with how I used to run my personal money was radically different than how I run these funds. I have a responsibility partners. I can't cowboy it up like I used to.
Right.
So for the fund, I try to my first trade. And this is, forget this market we're in, but when the VIX is over 25 or 30, I got to bring position size down. But in a normal market where the VIX is running at 13 to 20 or 15, whatever, I want to get my initial opening trade should be 10% of equity. Well, I mean, the first trade I put in.
Right.
Now, occasionally I'll call the trade. I'll say, back off that order. I want to see if there's somebody underneath it to hold it or keep it going up.
That's like Livermore. Livermore used to do that.
Yeah.
Test the waters, right.
Exactly.
Right.
But Now, let's say I get 10% on, and an hour later, it's up another 0.5%. I'll buy a few more. An objective, I want to get an 18% long position in before the stock is up 1.5%.
Okay.
And it just depends on how it's acting, how volume is, how the general conditions are in the overall market. So I want to get, I think once I get over 18% of equity in one stock, my risk into earnings is so great, I can really hurt equity. I don't want to draw down that big. So, but if you don't have over 10% in one position, it just doesn't matter. I think, you know, who cares if it goes up 100%?
Yeah, it doesn't matter. That's my,
like, why even bother?
Right. So how do you determine a too much of a position or too small of a position when it starts running and goes in your favor, which often happens with these big monsters, you know, leading stocks? How do you trim it down a little bit, or you just leave it, or how do you handle that?
Well, in the last few years, I have tried to be cognizant of the level of extension over the 50-day. Okay. And when it gets historically extended, I want to trim back 30%. I used to, when I started to implement it, I would only trim off 10 or 15, and it just wasn't enough to cushion the natural reaction down.
Okay.
You've got to sell more. You've got, for me, I need to trim that thing back 25 to 30%. And then when it gets down to the 50, which it's absolutely going to go to, yeah, if you're going to be in a position for 18 months or 9 months,
oh, yeah,
you need to expect multiple trips to the 50.
100%.
And so when it gets down there, you have to watch it. Is it catch support? Is there some big whales in there supporting it? Is it launched back up? Then you put that money back in. So you don't ever want to dislodge your core low-cost shares. I heard Bill say that 1,000 times. But to me, once you reduce a beautiful position below 70%, you're losing your critical mass. And this is something, I'm going to go on a tangent. Once you get a position and you get it in the right size in a real market leader, it's so rare. Almost, I would say 60% of opening positions I get stopped out of at a small loss, or just just didn't do it right. So it's rare to get bulk, good critical mass in a real leader. And I've seen people do it, and I have done it, where I get it all set up perfect. I'm ready to make a killing. And then for some reason, in the middle of the day, 3 weeks later, or a month later, I'm up 20, 30, 40, 50%. It'll flinch and I'll puke.
It's that one
that
second.
Is a massive epic violation, because you don't get the right stock in the right size at the right time very often. And when you do, you've got to sit. That is your game changer stock.
Right.
And people get out because it wiggled. It traded down, you know, I call them like Mother Teresa days or Gandhi days.
Yeah.
Where, you know, Mother Teresa went into a store one time and cussed out the clerk. Like, she wasn't perfect, but overall, she was an amazing person, and so was Gandhi. They had bad days.
Right.
So your greatest stock in the world is going to have a Gandhi day,
right,
and there's nothing wrong with it, but people puke.
Right.
And it's such a critical mistake, because you so rarely get positioned perfectly or very well. Once you do, you've really got to buckle down. So anyway, I took that thing so far off base.
No, that's
bring me back into line.
That's perfect. So how do you buckle down? Well, two questions for you. First thing is, you said as a stock gets too extended over the 50, you start to just trim a little bit, but you're expecting it to pull back, and then you're going to buy it if there's support near the 50. So how do you know when to start trimming? Is it a percentage above the 50, or is it a percentage above, is it an ATR? How do you exactly look to do that? Is the trend line
every stock has a personality?
Yeah, agreed.
And certain stocks, maybe a smaller, thinner stock, can get 30, 40, 50% over the 50 day. And then maybe a really liquid name like a Google or a, right, you name it, whatever,
right,
is only allowed, the market will only allow an extension of, say, 15 or 20%. It's germane to the personality of that stock. Even massive market cap stocks can get just gang tackled by institutions, and they can be allowed to extend greater than normal. So it's the historical, the current level of extension that the market allows.
Understood.
And also, that goes to the general market indexes. When animal spirits are raging, the NASDAQ can get 15% over the 50-day. It has happened.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But in most normal periods, when you don't have irrational exuberance, the NASDAQ rarely can exceed 6-7% over the 50-day. You get up there, you've got to be ready for, at the bare minimum, a sideways digestion, and most likely a 40%, 50% chance of a pullback all the way down to the 50.
Right.
So you've got to know, what is the environment you're in? What is the personality of your stock? And you also have to be aware of, this stock's personality before this last blowout earnings report in this new product was, it was only allowed to extend 5%. But now we're in a new environment, and now it's allowed to go 25. You've got to be dynamic in your assessment of the historical level of extension and the current environment. What is the market allowing? And that goes for the general market and individual names.
Next, so that's a really, really good point too. So what about getting out of position selling? When to sell? I know that's a big question I get from people all the time. How do you handle when to sell?
This is my worst attribute. It's not even an attribute. It's my downfall. I am such a massive optimist that, the simple answer to the question is, if it breaks the 50 on volume, and if it closes the week below the 50 by 3-5%, I'm probably out of a lot of it. That's my major guardrail. I call it the 50-day guardrail. Okay. I think moving averages that are faster than that are too fast, and they'll get you out unnecessarily. And then a climax top. Like, I have two major rules on selling. So 90% or more of my names, I'm taking over the top. I'm selling way off the top. And that is, I am not an offensive seller. I'm just not. And it's my worst point of my trading. I don't like to, I think everything I have is going to Mars. I think everything is going to change the world. And, you know, my objective is to get in a name and sit for 6 earnings reports that exceed massively, beat and raise quarters. And I think every little stock I own is going to do that. And they, most of them don't. So I draw down too much off. I very frequently am up 30, 40, 50% and then draw down too much because I take them over the top.
So a few things here. So have you always been an optimist?
To my own detriment with human beings and the markets.
Okay, even from childhood, because you spoke about your father being involved with the markets or helped open the door to that world for you. Was he an optimist as well?
He was a joyful person. He loved parties and he loved people and he loved to party. I am just like him.
Got it. So,
and my dad always thought that he could start a business that was going to grow to the sky. He always was reaching for the American dream.
Got it. Now that makes perfect sense. And then the other side of it, when a stock falls and breaks a 50, let's just say it's a little love tap and it shakes you out and you get tagged and then it turns around and goes back up again and you're out. Do you have any rules as far as getting back in? In other words, it was premature to stop out, or you realize the next day after you're out, like, damn, I shouldn't have sold, or whatever the case may be. How do you handle those situations?
Well, only because I've stopped out of a couple of the biggest stocks in history because it broke the 50, only for them to regain them occasionally in within an hour or two. And then I did it with Ascend Communications. I did it with Apple in after hours many years ago. I have got to buy them back. When you see these stocks that break below the 50 and they have these super long tails and then they close way high in the range or above the 50, not only is that a buyback, that is a screaming buy signal.
Right.
It's become in the last few 3-5 years a major signal for me. Did I answer that question? I buy them back.
Yeah, no, you buy them back. So do you buy them back once they get above the 50, or do you wait for them to break out to a new high?
I'll buy them back right away. Okay. I mean, in the day, and I kind of get excited and I say things like, I buy them back right away. I'll go in and I'll take an immediate 5% position. And if it goes higher, I'll buy, more and more and more. I'll keep buying it. I might buy a stock 7 times in a day.
7 times in a
day. That's not uncommon.
Got it. Now you buy by adding to the position or by buying?
Every position, trade higher, every lot of shares has got to be higher, higher, higher.
Got it. So no averaging down, averaging up instead. Is that correct?
Averaging down is like grabbing a sword with bare hands and having the guy yank it out of you.
Understood. That's the dumbest thing. Understood. So, okay, the next question for you, Jim, is with the losses, when you have a series of losses and you're out of the zone, so to speak, what do you do? Do you back off or do you trade lower as far as reducing or limiting a drawdown? Or how do you handle a series of losses?
In the bear market of 2000, over a long stretch, I think I had 13 losses in a row. But as you, the market is, by the time you have that many losses, the trend is definitively down. By the time you get to 13 in a row, you've probably tested a couple of different follow-through days. So you should never really get that far because the trend is down. The more losses I have, I kind of am starting to trade position size more by the VIX. When the VIX elevates greatly, I want to reduce size. Well, at least when the VIX is up because the market's going down. I do feel it is a sin to be a monster winner and not have enough size. Yeah. It doesn't matter if you get a five bagger if you don't have enough in there.
Right.
But again, I am always cognizant of what is the market allowing someone to make. You can't start a year and say, I'm going to be up 70% this year. Well, what if it's a dead sideways year?
Yeah, exactly.
But when the market's in an uptrend, you've got to size, for me, max about 18% of equity. And if I get four 18%ers and four of them go up 100%,
oh, Merry Christmas.
Now I'm having a good year.
Right, Merry Christmas. So do you – interesting here. So do you change your size and by using margin, or do you, when you're bullish and you say, hey, things are going well, like in 17 or 13 or whatever years the markets are just ripping higher, do you say, okay, fine, let me just lever up and just load up and go more than 18%? Or is 18 the cap as far as how big a position you'll allow to be in your portfolio?
It's an evolution. You know, I'm 55, I am in a much different world risk-wise. There's get rich and stay rich.
Right.
And
right.
I'm all about having giant years, but I'm not willing to, let me back up. When I was 25 or 30, I would put my whole account on margin 2X.
Okay.
Back in the day, you could do that.
Right.
And I would put half my account in one idea.
Right.
You know, but then a really, really wealthy guy who lived a few doors down from me said, Jim, price will hurt you, but size will kill you.
Yeah,
and he was dead right, because I did blow up many times back then. I position size as my has changed greatly as I've evolved. The amount of money I manage for other people, I'm not a cowboy anymore. I'm responsible for other people's money. And even if it was just my money, I just don't have the desire. I'm not trying to make – 300% years are just not on my radar screen anymore.
Right.
Position sizing for me has come way down. My use of leverage is very modest. I think the greatest magnitude of leverage I've had on in the last 10 years is 150%, maybe 160. And that was in a wildly extreme environment. Like normally 120, 30% long is more, you don't have to use much more than that to make an absolute killing.
Yeah, no question.
I mean, I'm talking about Rolls Royce private jet killing.
Right, no, understood. Okay. Understood. So talk about the psychology. When things are ripping and going in your favor, how does your psychology change versus when it's going completely against you?
Well, you know, it's just like the guy at the bar who's had 15 shots of Jack. I mean,
yeah.
He's freaking, you know, he's like so fired up. And that is a time when the risk is running higher than you perceive.
Understood.
After a long bull run, you are raging full of confidence. Everything's working. Your account has exploded in value. And you're drunk. You're not thinking clearly. It's, you know, being there, being in that position, being in the NBA final for the sixth time or fifth time, Michael Jordan, you know, you understand, hey, I've seen this before. You've got to dial it back. And only experience is going to help you tame that euphoria.
So, yeah, I actually have a great line. Once somebody starts pulling out their calculator, the market's going the other way.
Yeah, when you compound out for the next 20 years at that price, you're done.
That's my tell. That's when I'm like, okay, once the guy starts pulling out his calculator, I'm like, well, if I'm going to do, you know, that's when, okay, back off. So do you physically have any rules in place as far as how to handle that side of the equation? Because a lot of people don't talk about that, but it does happen. And I'm curious on how you handle both the upside euphoria and also the downside just feeling, you know, not feeling too
well,
hot.
I think one of the most important sentences someone could use only after you've got a gain worth owning is, I'm not giving it back. That line is so powerful, because now saying it And knowing what that price is and having a plan as you're drunk on excess profits is different. So you've got to, you know, having someone who's overseeing you, even me, I mean, I'm running a whole show here. I'm the risk manager, but I'm being critiqued by my associate Eve.
Right.
And so, you know, she maybe is more fearful than me in a lot of cases in the market, and she reigns in my my uber enthusiasm.
Right.
She keeps me grounded. One person, teams are better for me because I am susceptible to every human and emotion. Other person.
Yeah, that I agree with 100%. It's hard for a lot of canceling traders to understand that, but I couldn't agree with you more. Just being able to get out of your head. Tony Robbins has a good line. He goes, if you stay in your head, you're dead.
Yeah, I mean, do you play golf?
I do. Not good.
Okay. The more skilled you become at golf, the more it's a head game.
It is, 100%.
I mean, you know, it's like, hey, bogey is not going to kill you.
Right.
But triple is going to ruin your game.
Right.
You know, so you blow it off the tee, you miss the fairway, you're in a bunch of trees. Well, what are you going to do? Are you going to take a 4-iron and try and thread it through an impossible shot over the branches?
Yes,
or
seriously.
Are you going to pop it out in the fairway and say, look, I'm just going to accept bogey and walk away?
Right.
You know, there's a direct parallel between low scoring in golf, understanding yourself, your ability, where, you know, positioning, and getting to the finish line.
Yeah,
there's 100%. A direct parallel.
100%. I take it a step further and say any performance-based business, it's the exact same situation where a lot of it is mental. A lot of it comes, it's not, no one, you can't teach it. You have to learn it. You have to experience it. Like the color blue, what does blue look like if you've never seen it before? Or what does chocolate taste like? You physically can't tell someone what blue looks like or chocolate tastes like. But once you see it, you know it. It's the same situation.
I think, you know, I was at a gun range and I was shooting this target, and the guy was very complimentary about how I was shooting. And the guy says, another guy goes, yeah, he goes, how well do you think you'd be doing if that target was shooting back at you?
Right.
Well, when you're in the heat of the moment, right. That's only experience can teach you that. You can read Bill O'Neill's book or Darvish's book or Livermore, all the great books. But until you feel the emotional euphoria of having your account up 50-100%, and you're thinking about, I can buy this with it, or what my life will look like in 30 years, trading on papers, it's almost a waste. You eliminate the psychological pressures, not pressures, but euphorias and fears and all that stuff.
Yeah, 100%. And you have to go through it to experience it, right? So this is really good, Jim. So next question for you. What are some timeless lessons you've learned along the way that you'd like to share with the audience that we haven't already covered?
You know, a guy named Lee Freestone taught me you need to get a base, get a chart, and you analyze every bar. Go bar by bar. Is it accumulation or is it distribution? Because what it looks like may not be. And just go through every single bar. And then what I also said about how when you have those massive gap downs, this is another variable, another lesson. When it closes at the dead high or, God forbid, back above the 50, and the volume is going to be 4 times normal, that is a major buy signal. With the advent of Reg D and earnings reports being so important, a lot of people are like freaking out, like, oh, it just causes these gap downs and it's a disaster. Well, at the same time, it also causes gap ups,
right.
And those are massive buying opportunities in this environment. And I don't see that Reg D changing for a long time. Gaps are just massive signals to you. And then you have to have the guardrail. Like, say, forget the, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7% loss cutting. How do you cut your losses or get out of positions when you're rocking? That's your guardrail, is the 50-day moving average. There's three or four, I guess.
No, that's good. So that's really good. So you talked about selling 3, 4, 5, 6% below, and O'Neill talks about 7 or 8. Can you go back and talk about how you handle a position after you enter? It can either go up, down, or sideways. So assuming it goes up and sideways, we handle that, no problem. But what about when it goes down? How do you handle those?
A third down 3, a third down 5. When I first got started, it was 7 or nothing.
Okay.
And then when you start to run larger amounts of money, you just can't get out at one specific price.
No question.
So then I went to 3, 5, 7. And like in a market like we're in, as time progresses, I think you're going to be less tolerant of a 3, 5, 6, 7% loss. I think very, very few pros are going to take a loss that big.
Got it.
So I think with experience, you're going to trade radically less, and you will not accept bigger losses. But on the other side, I see people so afraid that they start cutting losses at even. And I'm like, that's not realistic. Stocks fluctuate.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Granted, anything below the pivot is, assuming you don't buy extended, even 1% extended, you need to give these things room. And especially if you're buying, let's say you have a follow per day and you don't really start getting in for a week or two, well, now the market's elevated. Your breakouts are going to pull back way more because the market's going to – breakouts are going to work about as well as the general market is right. after you buy it.
Right.
So if you buy right at a follow through day, that stock should be up 5, 10, 15, 20% immediately, and you won't have to deal with it. But if you get into a market where the follow through day is passed – and you're now buying lower quality. You shouldn't be buying lower quality, but the point is this. You have to give a stock 3%. If you sell prior to that, you're just not – it's like suffocating a putt. You need a putt.
Yeah,
if you don't get that bubble in the hole, it has zero chance to go in.
Yeah.
If you cut all your losses at even or whatever, you're suffocating a possible monster. And another mantra I have is I'm giving my stocks every possible opportunity to succeed. I'm going to let them go. I'm giving them the time. I'm giving them wiggle room. I want to let them blossom. I don't drink wine that is young. I drink all my California cabs 10 years, 13 years.
Right.
I am patient with them. Now, if they're losers, now I'm out.
Got it.
But you don't suffocate your trades.
Right.
People who are nervous or fearful suffocate their trades. They get into a Home Depot in the first stage base 30 years ago, and they got a life changer, and what do? They suffocate it.
They blow out, yeah. They choke it. Yeah. Yeah, that makes perfect sense. So next question I was like to ask is, what are some timeless mistakes you see people make that we haven't discussed, and how do you avoid them?
Well, I do it today. And this is a great in this exact moment we're in, I see brilliant people, 30,000 times smarter than me, saying we are going to have social unrest, the oil, the disruptions in the oil market. You could paint a case right now that is cataclysmic.
Right.
And on the other side of the coin, I see people who are, again, infinitely more intelligent than me with the most optimistic cases where we're going to come back way more efficient, way stronger. It's like the forest fire burned through and cleared out all the brush. The growth that comes back is going to be so much more virile and vibrant. Well, I'm susceptible to listening to others. I have to tune all that crap out, literally no TV, but I do read experts, people who I know are smarter than me. And in the end, I'm like, why am I reading all this research? Because all I have to do is follow the trend.
Right.
And now that you've got to juxtapose that with, it's very important for me to understand the fundamentals of why the general market is going up in an uptrend. Why is this individual stock that I'm long changing the world? So you've got to strike a balance between reading brilliant people who are smarter than you. And I used to talk to Bologna a lot, and he'd go, oh, my target on XYZ is, Google's 800, and it'd be at 200.
Yeah.
And so I'd hang up the phone with him, and I'd have Bill says 800. Well, 3 days later, Bill will sell it, and I'd be like, it's a sell signal, but Bill said 800.
Right.
It was better for me to have Bill's fishing pole than Bill's fish.
Understood.
The rules are what I needed.
Right.
In the end, I don't want Bill to tell me that he thinks it's 800 target. What I want him to say is, Jim, as long as it stays above the 50, you stay with this thing.
Understood. And then eventually.
So don't listen to other people, but then do listen to other people.
Right. No, understood. Take it all in, but be able to intelligently synthesize it and use what matters and leave the rest. In other words, filter out the noise and focus on the pertinent information that helps you make money.
Right. And when the trend changes against the bullish news to the out.
Got it. Get out. So, Jim, this is a lot of really good advice, and thank you so much. What is the final question here? What is the best piece of advice you can share with the audience on and off Wall Street?
Anybody can change their life, and I mean anybody but you've got to give a lot of effort and you've got to consistently try. You just never, ever, ever, ever give up. You can do anything if you not just write it down and have goals, but you work towards it. You've got to take the steps to move forward. And in the market, if you do that, you can make more money than you could ever need. And anybody can do it, from a person who grows up in object poverty, a minority in object poverty with in a wheelchair with one eye, could become a billionaire if you follow those rules.
Yeah, no, I love it. It's really good advice. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show. It's been an absolute delight.
Dude, you rock. Thanks for having me. And good luck to you. And I hope to talk to you down the road in the future when everything's straightened out. We've made a killing.
Sounds great.